Hey, I want to say welcome to this video. I'm together here with Ilse and Reino, who are helping with running the pioneer training schools all over the world. And we want to do a video here that is very different from many of the other videos you have seen. Maybe you have seen our movie, The 7 Days Adventure with God, the movie, The Last Reformation. Maybe you've seen the pioneer school and some of the teaching we have. And very often it's teaching about what it is to be a disciple of Christ, how it is to share the gospel, and how to heal the sick, cast out demons, how to be led by the Holy Spirit, and positive teaching about God and the Christian life. This video is going to be very different because this video is more going to be a warning video, a video where we are going to look at something that is not so good, something that have crept into the church. And the truth is that we see a need for making a video like this now. And what are we going to talk about in this video?
Yeah, the sad thing is there's a lot of new age coming in, and this is what we're going to look at. We're going to look at things like strange manifestations. We have tics and kriyas and kundalini spirit, and we have, which is also a false holy spirit. We have theophostics and inner healing.
Muscle testing.
All sorts of things that people are bringing in, and it's a new age root, but they now want to call it God. They now want to say this is the Holy Spirit in the world.
They relabeled
it
as a Christian label.
Yeah. Bring it into the church. We're going to look a lot about those things later. And again, there is a reason we are doing this video, and that is that the Last Reformation is growing. We are meeting many people all over the world. And we meet these new age things many places. Some places more than others, but we want to do a video to say that this is wrong. This is something we are not part of, and we need to be better to discern what is from God and what is not from God. Yeah. If we look at some of the things Ilse just talked about with kriyas and tics and kundalini spirit and manifestation, we can talk about drunk in the spirit and all of that. Some of you know what we are talking about. Some of you have no idea. If you go on YouTube and write kundalini spirit, manifestations, drunk in the spirit, and write some of that, you will find a lot of videos out there where there is many who actually done videos where they are warning against it, where they are talking about it and saying that that have crept into the church. Yeah. I think it's good to look at some of those videos, but don't see too much. Don't focus on what is bad, but it's good to be aware of it so you know what it is. And then when you know what it is, focus on the truth instead. Focus on what the Bible says. And we actually also start with the Bible here, because the Bible have given us clear commands, not only when it comes to the gospel, not only when it comes to discipleship, not only when it comes to Christ and what it is to follow Him, but also clear commands when it comes to discerning spirit, discern what is from God, what is not from God, when it comes to testing, when it comes to warnings, be careful, because false spirits is going to creep into the church, and many people in the end time are being deceived. So we will start a little with looking at the Bible. Then we talk about the two ditches, because there's people here who are skeptics against everything, and there's people here who receive everything as is from God. Yeah. And then I'm going to tell my story about it, how I left some of the charismatic church and the faith movement because I saw that there was something that was not good. Ilse and Ryan is going to tell their story. And after we have told our stories, we will go more into details, where we'll talk about the drunk in the spirit and holy laughter. What is that? We're going to look at impartation. We are going to look at manifestations, and then we will end it up. So this is some of the things that's going to happen in this video.
Yeah.
Let's start with the Bible.
Yeah. So we can see many people claim the highest authority and then don't taste it. So we can clearly see in 1 John 4, where we see, dear friends, do not believe everyone who claims to speak by the Spirit. You must taste them to see if the Spirit that they have come is from God. For there are many false prophets in the world. This is how we know that this is the Spirit of God. If a person is claiming to be a prophet, he acknowledges that Jesus came in the flesh. Mm. And then we also have another one that is quite strong in Galatians. Galatians says, he was writing there, he says in Galatians verse 6, 1 verse 6, I'm shocked that you are turning away so soon from God, who called you to himself through the loving mercy of Christ. You are following a different way that pretends to be the good news, but it is not the good news at all. You are being fooled by those who deliberately twist the truth concerning Christ. Mm. That's serious.
So again, the Bible, Paul gave warnings. When he say, test the spirit, don't receive everything like light is from God. We have to test it. There is a reason he said that. Yeah. What is the reason? We need to test it. The reason is because false spirit, false teaching is actually creeping into the church. And in Galatians further, he also said, if even our angel for heaven come and preach another gospel, curse unto him. Mm. Why do he say that? Because at that time, and to be honest, in the church today, there is people who share manifestations where like, hey, it was our angel came and revealed this, or it was the Holy Spirit that revealed that, but it go against the scripture. And how do we test things? We test it, of course, by the fruit. Yeah. We test, you know, a tree by the fruit. We test it by what we say, if they proclaim Christ. Yes. And that is not our word only. That is a lifestyle. So they're actually living the holy life and so on. But also for the word.
Yeah. Because the spirit will never contradict the word of God.
No.
Yeah, so if you see a contradiction being preached and the actions, then you know something is wrong. Mm. You never contradict it.
So if we love God and we do that, we need to recognize that every person can be deceived. Mm. The Bible again warn against it. Like, go back from the... It started from the beginning, how Adam and Eve was deceived by Satan. Mm. And how Satan now come as an angel of light to deceive people. And the Bible said that in the end time, many, many, many people would fall away because they're listening to deceiving spirits. And it's not everyone who said, Lord, Lord, to him who actually are going to enter into the kingdom of God. Many one day will say, have I not prophesied, not healed the sick, I not cast out demons, have not done that in your name? And he said, away from you, I never knew you. I never known you. Yeah. Now there's two ditches, because some of the scriptures we have just used now, we also know there is people actually using them against us, against everything. Yeah. The quote I just came with, that in the end time, many will say, Lord, Lord, have we not healed the same? Have we not done that in your name? And Jesus said, away from you, I never knew you. I've heard people quote that to say that healing, deliverance, the power of the Holy Spirit ceased with the apostles. Mm. And therefore, everyone who believe in healing and cast out demons, look, they're deceived because Jesus said that. So that's two ditches. Jesus did not say that healing was wrong. He did not say we should not cast out demons. But he says what we have there, that we need more than that. We need to live a holy life. We need the fruit of it. And the truth is, we talk about that later, the truth is we have also seen it. We have seen people who have learned to heal the sick in faith, who walk in it. Maybe they start good, but they end bad. Or people who have never really repented, never really come into the knowledge of who Christ is. So we need to discern things, we need to test things.
Yeah, that's it. And the thing is as well, God always confirms his word. He is the healer. So Jesus is the one that heals. And just because you see somebody that heals, doesn't mean God is
confirming
that person. Mm. He's confirming who he is. He's the healer. So that's why you can see sometimes somebody standing up and doing healings, but the action or the fruit in the life is maybe not matching the word of God.
It comes out that they're fallen in pornography or they're cheating on their wives or whatever the case may be. And people go, it's like, oh, but he was this man of God. Mm. You are a man of God if you obey God, not because you're just healing the sick or preaching the gospel.
But there's two ditches, there's two sides, and there is there's people who are really open for the Spirit and they love everything. Mm. that if there's a manifestation, then that is good, and they believe everything is from God. And then there's the other side who's against everything when it comes to the work of the Holy Spirit and the power of God. I believe that we need to be in the middle of the road. I believe that we need to have a discernment. We need to test things by the word and the word only, not by our experience, not by our emotion, not by our feelings, not by our dreams, not by our visions, but on the word. But at the same time, if we really have a sound doctrine and when we have an understanding of the true understanding of who Christ is and the Holy Spirit and the word, then of course we will have manifestation. Of course, we will see the Holy Spirit fall. Of course, we will see healing. We will cast out demons. We will see those things.
Yeah.
And so I would say there's like two legs we need to walk on. One leg is the word, and then one leg is the spirit. We experience the spirit, but it needs to line up with the word. The word needs to line up with spirit. Those two things don't go against each other. So I think this video is also going to shock more people, because this is actually a video warning against things. But this video is not coming from somebody who warns against everything that had to do with the work of the Holy Spirit and the healing. And if you go on YouTube and search of some of those things we are going to say here, many people actually warn against those things. It's correct what they're saying. But often they warn against everything. They warn against, like, healing have ceased with the apostles, and I heard a video like, no, these signs don't follow those who believe anymore, because the sign is for the Jews, and we are not Jews, and therefore the sign is for the Jews. We need knowledge, we need wisdom, we have the Bible, we don't need signs anymore. That goes against the Bible, that goes against the understanding on the Bible and church history, because the signs did not stop with the apostles. The signs did not only go for the Jews. The Gentiles, through the hands of Peter and Paul later and all over the place, they experienced the Holy Spirit. They saw the signs. So we are not against the work of the Holy Spirit. We love to see the Holy Spirit.
We walk in signs and wonders ourselves.
Every day.
We want to see it. And I've seen it's not to discern things, to be skeptical, in a sound skeptic, is not a hindrance to have the work of the Holy Spirit. It's not a hindrance, but people have often put it up in a way that if, no, we like, put your mind away. I've heard like people, have you heard something like that? Yeah. Don't think, don't be religious. Yeah. Don't, come on, be careful.
Get out of the box.
What?
Get out of the box.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Where it become unhealthy.
Yes.
But let's start. So the Bible talk about discerning things, talking about wrong spirit, talking about testing things. Ilse and Rhino come from a charismatic background like this. I also came from a charismatic background like some of those things. So I will start with my story, and then you can tell your story. When I came in church many years ago, in 95, that is 22 years ago right now, I experienced God. And it was a faith movement church, charismatic church. And you know, when you are new in the faith, everything you see, you just accept. I as a new believer who have never opened the Bible, never studied the word, if I came in and people said, whoa, this is the Holy Spirit working, I was like, hallelujah, this is the Holy Spirit working. You will not, as a new believer, ask question, because you think that those people around you, they know what they're talking about. Yeah. So I accepted many things, and I was part of churches where they got drunk in the spirit, and they gold dust, and I heard of all of those things we are going to look at later. But some years later, we had actually a meeting where there was a guy from America who came with like a big campaign, and he was going to talk about all of those things with manifestation, all of that. And it became actually the beginning of the end for me when it came to that kind of charismatic movement. Because at that meeting, a lot of things happened with people strong in spirit. But in that meeting, I saw that many people was pretending. They were not honest. Mm. They were pretending. For some, that guy there, he invited his wife up, and as soon as he came out, she was like drunk. And as soon as he sat down, she was normal. And it happened again and again. And I was like, what is happening here? Mm. Is there really not more fear of God in this place? Mm. But what happened at, there was a meeting there where a lot of people came, and there was, people was falling down, and there was some of the shaking, and some things I understood and some things I did not understand, but it was many years ago. I don't know what I knew at that time, what I know today. But I had a friend with me who was like an evangelist, and he suddenly left the meeting. So a few days later, I wrote to him and said, hey, where were you? I didn't see you at the meeting anymore. And he wrote back, no, I left it because it was a big circus. And I was like, what?
That's wrong.
How can he say that? You are not allowed to speak against the Holy Spirit. It was what I grew up in, like,
don't blaspheme
the Holy Spirit. And I'm like, how can he say that? So I wrote to him, how can you say that? You're not allowed to speak against the Holy Spirit. And he wrote back. And I remember reading his email. He said, if the Holy Spirit was there, where was the conviction of sin, righteous judgment? Where was this and this? And he talked about what we see the Holy Spirit is doing. And when he wrote that, I was like, oh, I wanted to write back right away, because he should not come here and go against judge what I came from. But I couldn't write back, because I was like, Cinder, he's actually right. Mm. Because there was a big campaign, there was a lot of manifestations. Mm. But now the campaign was over. Mm. And what was the fruit? There was no life really changed. There was no conviction of sin. There was no deep, deep repentance, and there was no gospel preached, and all of the things was not there. And it actually became a journey for me where I'm like, something is wrong. Something is wrong. So I started to listen to preachers that was not so charismatic, but who have more sound doctrines. And it was so good. It was like first time getting meat in my life. Like, I've been living by milk my whole my Christian walk, and then I got a good beef and something that was solid, something that was good, a good focus on Christ and the cross and Jesus and discipleship. And I loved it. Mm-hmm. I listened to it. But also after some time listening to that, I felt like I still need more. Mm-hmm. I also want the work of the Holy Spirit. And it was like my life one time, I thought I needed to choose. Put my brain away and just receive everything like being from God, or go over on that side where there is not much power of the Holy Spirit and healing and deliverance. But the truth is, we don't need to choose. We are called to walk in the middle of the road. We are called to discern things, called to have a sound doctrine. And sound doctrine is not only words, that is power. Mm. Power of the Holy Spirit. It was my journey started. Mm. At one time we were working with different churches, and I got invited to a friend who was pastor in a church. And I went there, and when I came into that meeting, it was a weird meeting. I was like, what is happening? People got talking about gold dust and feathers, and talk about, they have like pictures with light, they're taking a picture where there was like light on it. So say, hey, look, there's an angel here and there's an angel there. Mm. And the whole focus at that meeting was manifestation. Mm. Not the gospel, not the Bible, just manifestation.
No repentance.
No. And I saw some of those weird things there. There was a woman walking around like a chicken, bah, 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 prophesying over people. And I was like, what is happening
here?
It
actually steers people away.
Yeah, it do.
It does. New believers.
But I think many of us, we were still like, okay, we just need... don't judge. It was so much in us that from our background, don't judge, don't be against the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, the fear of blaspheming. Yeah.
But actually that meeting make me one time of all actually break with all of that.
Yeah.
Because at that meeting, I knew the pastor. he experienced what he said was he experienced the Holy Spirit came over him, he fell down. And another woman experienced the Holy Spirit over her and she fell down. And they were laying on the floor beside each other. And then they got the same vision. In the vision, they went to heaven and Jesus married them with each other. So he came out of that vision, told his leadership, this is what God had done.
So they were married now.
Yeah, God have married us already, and when you are married, you can go to bed with each other.
Course,
so
yeah.
He could now go to bed with her, even though not married on paper, because Jesus had married them. That is weird.
That is.
But he was already married.
Oh, no.
With another woman,
and he had two kids. And I'm like, when I heard that, and also heard that there was actually people around him who accepted that, like being the work of the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
I can say very clear without any wrong fear of blaspheming the Holy Spirit and say something wrong, that is not the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, because we can say such the word of God.
We can say, and the Holy Spirit is clear. God will never marry somebody with another person who's already married with one person. Like that. This is crazy. And of course, the fruit of that was many people saw it. Some people did not see it. They were so deceived. So the church split.
Of course.
And the rest fall away later. And I would say that this is the biggest danger, that when we start with manifestation, we build doctrine about, and like if there's a manifestation, oh, God must be here and therefore is correct.
Yes.
So we don't test it anymore. We don't check it by the word.
Mm.
So I've seen people fall away because of wrong spirit, like Paul said there.
Yeah.
I have seen it. I was part of it in that way that many, many years ago when I came to faith, I was in church where I saw a lot of weird things.
Mm.
I left it. At one time, I went out in the other side and listened to something, but I think something is also wrong here.
Mm.
We need to see the power of God. We need the Holy Spirit. And then I came back where I was at the middle of the road, and we have been walking here for years now. And you who have seen our videos, you know, come on, we believe in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's so beautiful.
Yeah,
and what is the work of the Holy Spirit? That is, He leads people to repentance.
He does, yeah.
He leads people to a holy life. He leads people. The Holy Spirit is not there to get focus on himself. The Holy Spirit is there to get focus on Christ.
Yes.
To focus on Christ, Jesus, the cross, what Jesus have done.
Amen.
So this is my journey.
Yeah.
So I came from that background. I went up in the other side because I will not have anything to do with this. I have a few years there, but then I found the middle.
Mm.
And now it's just, okay, if we just focus on Jesus, we don't spend a lot of time focusing on manifestation, but if we focus so much on Jesus and discipleship, we will see manifestations. We will see the power of the Holy Spirit.
That's beautiful.
What is your story?
Well, while you were talking, I was thinking the problem with deception is when people are deceived, and we were there, you don't know when you are deceived. Especially when you're a new believer, you don't know how to taste yet with the Word of God.
You think you are tasting.
You think you are tasting, but you're actually not tasting.
Yeah.
So we were deceived. We both grew up Dutch Reformed. And then for me, I got baptized or filled with the Holy Spirit in a Spirit-filled church. But I didn't taste everything that was happening there. So we've got a very similar testimony where we saw all these manifestations happening in the church as well, people getting drunk. But because we came from such the side where nothing happened, we just grabbed it with both hands because suddenly there was life. There was more than just a...
Well, something was happening.
Something was exciting.
Yeah. The difference was, though, what we often found is because we believed in this whole anointing, special impartation, drunken, whatever it was, I often... Sunday after Sunday, so many times we would go to church, we would have this amazing meeting, people rolling around, laughing...
Mm.
Holy chaos, they would call it.
Mm.
And I would go home, even though we were also on the floor, we were also laughing.
Mm.
The difference was I would go home and I would feel so rejected.
Yeah.
Because I laughed to be a part of it. I saw other people rolling around laughing.
Mm.
I often started by laughing at them.
Yeah.
And then it was like, oh, you're a part of us? And
I actually felt like a hypocrite at one stage because I knew I was just, I wasn't sure if they, I thought they had the real thing, but I was just laughing because I didn't want to feel left out. So I felt like a hypocrite because I portrayed as if it's also the Holy Spirit that is doing this with me.
Yeah.
But
and we just felt so rejected. It's like, when will the Holy Spirit touch us? Yeah. When will we be good enough for Him to wanna
work
give
with
us that kind of experience, I suppose.
Yeah.
And then our journey, same thing. We were there for a while. It was always the same people that laughed the loudest and fall over. And then we started to see a thing as well where the one lady I remember that was always on the floor, the service hasn't even started, she's already manifesting. She left her husband for another man.
Yeah.
And then another couple, same thing, the spirit-filled people start having adulterous affairs. And it was just shocking. We stood back, was like, what is going on here? And then we immigrated and we actually had friends that came to the airport. They were too scared to do it before. But they came to the airport and they gave us a DVD just about the truth versus mystical experiences. And that really opened our eyes. And at first it was really hard
to see. It was devastating for me. To see that,
it was very hard because, hold on, we thought we were testing the spirit. We thought, but we just take the pastor's verses with the pastor's glasses, looking at his, in his context, not in the context of the word. And we were shocked, firstly, that we were deceived. That was hard. But the relief, like, God has not rejected me. I am spirit-filled. I am speaking in tongues. I want a holy life. And my life is actually closer to what I see in the Bible than what I saw in the church.
But you always find scripture.
Yes.
And says the way he tempted Jesus in the desert, he did not use the satanic words of the Bible at that time. He used the word.
Yes.
But word out of context, one verse out of context says something different than words in context.
Yes.
And this is often we see like we with the drunkenness, all that. We have Book of Acts too. They were drunk, but they were not dancing around like drunk. They were filled by the Spirit. There was a boldness coming, because what is to be drunk? We can meet people who are drunk in the real life. There is a little bold, but you also meet people who are drunk in the real life who are weird. So this is so we need to see it in context, and the first early Christian, they did not walk around weird. I think there was a boldness where other people say, whoa, why are they so bold? What is happening here? Are they like drunk? Because there was a boldness and a joy and a strength. Not that they were dancing around weird and pretending and laying on the floor. And so, but because we have a verse or two, we easily accept it as being the truth. But also what you say, I think, you say it was there was nothing wrong with you. Can you say something? Because I think this is what many people out there actually, why they need to see the teaching. Because when we started to talk about this at our schools a little and all over, there was many people say, oh, I'm so happy to hear this. Because I thought, what was wrong with me?
And it was, it was the same with us. It was, we did manifest. It was in the flesh. We wanted to be a part of it. When someone laid hands on me, I fell. I chose to lie on the floor because I didn't want to be the odd one standing when everyone else was on the floor. Peer pressure. I laughed. I laughed at people. I laughed with people. It was not a demonic manifestation. It was flesh. I wanted to be a part of it. But then the relief when I realized I didn't have to do it. This is not necessarily the whole, I'm not saying it's a demon, but it's not the Holy Spirit. And there was nothing wrong with me. I am accepted by God. I didn't need this to prove that I am a child of God, that I am loved, that I am accepted. I needed the word of God to prove that I am loved and accepted. This is what I needed to measure my life against.
And what I like as well, what we see as well, you know, the fruits of the Holy Spirit, if we look at that, just a few of them. One thing that really stood out for me is self-control. So we need to have self-control when we manifest, when we walk by the Spirit. There's always self-control. We need to be loving and kind and gentle, and self-control is a big thing because many of these manifestations we do see is there's a lack of self-control. I question some of those things. And so if there's no self-control and it's not the fruit of the Holy Spirit, What is it?
Who's manifesting?
What is, you know, and that is a big thing for me. So we need to be able to always stand up and ready to give our testimony, share the gospel, to speak about repentance. But many times when you see these meetings that people gather, it's nothing happens like that. There's no repentance. There's nothing like that.
And so for us, the word.
For us, it was freeing when I saw that and realized, wow, we can walk in self-control and I can preach the gospel. I don't have to fall over to know that God loves me. Yeah. It was so freeing for me. It was really, I knew God loves me because His word says that, and He cannot lie. God says He loves me, that He planned me before the foundation of the earth. I don't have to fall over to be loved by God.
And also, I would say that there is the, when you're together with many people, it's easy to get
hyped up.
Well, I would say that we have seen people fall and get set free from demons. Yes. We have seen people fall and experience the power of the Holy Spirit and strong things. And I love it when it happened out on the street. But it should be the same. I'm always worried if you have to have a 1.5 hour worship first before something can happen. But I don't see that. I see the Holy Spirit should be in us, over us, with us. And when we pray for people and cast demons out, there is a manifestation. And especially when it happened to people I've never experienced before out on the street. Mm. And so on, you know it's real, it's not hype up. And I would say for my own sake also, when I repented like 5th of April 1995, deep, like I cried out to God and the Holy Spirit came powerful. I've never fallen down, I did not know anything about it. I was totally new in it, but the Holy Spirit just came with a power, filled me up and I fall down. And I was laying with the most incredible feeling to my whole body and I was like, this is God. This is God of the universe who touched me right now. This is God. And it was so powerful. And I stood up and I was changed. Amen. I was totally changed. I couldn't let go of that moment. I have experienced God. Since that, to be honest, I learned to fall like they did. Because you admit and so on. But I would say never, never anything like this. It was more like, okay, you did it and you got hyped up. And again, life did not get changed that time. So we are not against the work when it's truly the Holy Spirit. But we don't focus on it. The goal is not to get people to fall. The focus is not that. And also, you don't need to have the same experience I had with the Holy Spirit. Yeah. I pray for many who have got the Holy Spirit and speaking tongues where it's like, and stand and worship God and it just... I've never experienced that myself. Mm. I have never experienced that. Mm. When they prayed for me with the Holy Spirit, it's like when I started speaking tongues, it was not a powerful thing. Mm. But it don't matter. Because I don't live by experience, I live by the word. Okay. And so on. So not be envy of other people's experience, because let the Holy Spirit work deep in your life.
Yes.
And go for it.
What I can see, people are driven by feelings. They want to feel God or experience God by a physical feeling or the manifestation of falling over to feel the love of God. Mm. But we shouldn't walk by feelings. Mm. We should walk by the Spirit and not by the flesh.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big thing that I had a breakthrough because I wanted to feel. I had a lot of rejection in my life growing up. So it was important for me to want to feel the love of God. And when I didn't feel that, I had to almost take control of that and fall over so that I can show but God loves me. But when I touched earlier about it as well, when I knew the love of God, it's first a knowing that God loves me before it's a feeling. Yes, the feeling does come. I have experienced many times with God, I know God loves me, and I had some manifestation where I knew God is there. But it's first a knowing that God loved me, and that changed everything for me.
So if we believe, the Bible says, test everything, try everything. And we, just because you grow up in something, don't mean that it's correct. Mm. We need to, it's okay to ask questions. Mm. It's okay to test things. The Bible says, test it, try it, and hold on to what is good. Mm. We both got saved, and God used all over. Also, when there's things that's wrong, people still come to faith. Yeah. We both got saved into churches. Well, there was many good things, but there was also something that was really bad.
Yes.
Part of the walk with Christ is then that we get rid of the bad things and come into what is good. So that should be like that. So we don't judge you out there also who come get saved into those backgrounds like we are. But the work of the Holy Spirit should work in you also, that you start to ask questions and start to discern things, grow up in understanding and knowledge, so you can then recognize that this is wrong and get rid of it and then take what is good. If we look at the things, some of the things we can talk about first is drunkenness and holy laughter. Can you say what that is if people don't know what it is?
So basically what it is, it's almost people get hyped up. So when they believe, when the Holy Spirit comes on you, there's an uncontrollable laughter or joy that comes over you. Now, I've experienced some joy, of course, and joy, we have got joy in the Lord, and the joy of the Lord is our strength. We know that, it's scripture. But what we see with this manifestation is this uncontrollable laughter where they really get hyped up and it's almost contagious and
it's disruptive.
And people start falling on the ground, rolling and laughing and making animal noises with the laughter, and it's just, it doesn't stop, it just keeps on going.
It takes over the preaching, yes.
It does.
And also the drunk, like people going around like drunk and falling down and standing up and falling down. And
we've actually seen a service where the pastor was ready to preach the word, and he had his word, the Bible, ready to preach, and then he started laughing. And he couldn't stop laughing, and then he says, I cannot preach today, I need to put down the word of God. And that is shocking. This is the word of God.
There's no self-control.
There's no self-control. Yeah.
You can see videos on YouTube about that. Is it demonic or is it not demonic?
I don't want to be the judge of that, and I don't think we should judge, but I think we can judge it by the word of God. And
I would say there's three things. There is demonic, there is Holy Spirit, or there is the soul.
Yes.
What I experienced with this is that I, when I was new in the faith, I was at meetings where people was laughing and falling around, all of that you see on YouTube. And I somehow learned to drink also. I was like thinking, oh, now I'm drinking. I felt like, oh, in my body, and I almost couldn't stand, and I fall down, and I felt it all over my body. At that time, I thought it was the Holy Spirit. Why? Because I did not have any discernment. Then I God started to reveal to me and give me discernment and see what the word was saying, and I started to ask questions. Then I met a woman who just put everything in place for me. It was actually a non-Christian woman who came to one of those meetings, and she was a drug addict, not born again. She came in and she said, hey, I know this. I'm like, what? I know this. And I was like, you don't know this. Come on, you have never been in church before. You cannot know what this is. And she said, yeah, we do it often. I'm like, and I was saying, like, come on, you often do the work of the Holy Spirit working, like, it don't make sense. And she said, we just call it dry fixing. I said, what? We call it dry fixings. And she said, when me and my friends, we did not have money to buy drugs, we pretended that we took drugs. And we were like smoking in, like this, like... And then, ha ha ha, you. And then they breathe in, like they were smoking, like they were taking drugs. And they start to feel emotion, starts to feel something in the body. Yeah, and they got high. When she said that, I was like, what? And then when I thought back, I was in a church where people was drunk. I could not drink like them. I was thinking like you, what is wrong with me? But one day I just gave everything, said, I want it. And I did like this. And then suddenly I thought, yes, now I feel it, because, I feel numb in my hands or my body and on my hands, and I start to get dizzy and I fall down. That was not the work of the Holy Spirit. That was hyperventilating. I was breathing too much oxygen in too fast, and my body reacted. And when I suddenly understood that, I was like, how crazy is that? Here we had a church in Denmark. I was new in the faith, I did not know better. But here we have a church in Denmark with a few hundred people running around hyperventilating and thinking this is God. that is not God. I would say in that case, that is also not demonic, but that is totally soulish.
Yes.
So we have people creating soulish manifestation, worshiping like it was God. And then I understand why people was carrying out in the car after the meeting, drove home, come back the next week, the same experience, carried out, drove home, and was not changed.
Yes. Yeah.
Because you don't get changed by soulless experience. You get changed by the work of the Holy Spirit and by the word of God. So for me, when she said that, it just became so clear that, come on. And also with the holy laughter thing, how do people do that in church? They're like, hoo, hoo, ha, ha. And one start to laugh, ha, 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 and then laugh and go around and look at each other. And then the next one thing is funny, ha, 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 one, ha, ha, ha. And suddenly, more laughter, more laughter. In the end, there's people who laugh so much that they're running around on the floor, pain in the stomach and laughing. That is not, I will not say demonic, but that is not the Holy Spirit.
No. But the scary part though is so when it starts with a fleshy thing, but I believe if you chase
it, it can be.
It becomes demonic.
But the holy, the laughter thing, you actually have that out in the world. In Denmark, we have laughter clubs. That is where people come together and laugh. I did it with some friends some years ago just for fun because we talked about it, how laughter is irritation.
Contagion.
Where we were together in a summer house, some friends, and we said, let's laugh, ha, 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 ha. And we create a laugh, and in the end, I actually start to laugh real, like correct. And I was laughing so much, so every time I heard them laugh, I was also laughing, and I had pain in my stomach, and I was like, I need to go away, and I no matter where I was in the house, I still heard their laugh. So I was laughing. There's nothing wrong with laughing. Don't hyperventilate, that is... Sorry, that is stupid. That is why. Laugh is good, but don't call it the work of the Holy Spirit. Then it's laughing. This is okay to laugh, but the problem is that people create a manifestation, and there's so people today traveling around the world and doing those soulless things. With getting people to, now we are drinking, now we are drinking, and the music is correct, and you come into emotion. There's no preaching, there's no repentance, and no work of the Holy Spirit. And people are laughing and running around, and very often some people get disappointed because some people say also, what is wrong with me?
Exactly. Yeah.
So, and some people think, I tried God, but it didn't work. So, but as you say, if you give you over to something, and if you are seeking manifestation, you can open up for something that
and
is
you need
demonic.
You do need deliverance. Yeah.
But if you go on YouTube, don't see too many videos, but if you go on YouTube, whole drunk in spirit, there's people like, oh, Holy Ghost, Marijuana, Holy Ghost, and people like, and come on, that have nothing to do with God, that have nothing to do with the Bible, and that is nothing to do with the Holy Spirit. That is hyperventilating. That is, as he called it, dry fixing. They do that out in the world, but we should not do that in the church.
God called us to be sober in the mind, especially in the last days. We need to be sober-minded.
Yeah. So we want to say, but I believe at the same time, I believe people can have a hurt inside and the Holy Spirit can come over them and they can experience
joy.
A joy and experience a holy joy and also laugh, even something come over them and they experience a freedom, but it's not something you create by doing it in a certain way. It's the work of the Holy Spirit, and it's not for everyone. It's not something you uncontrollable
can.
Yeah, there's self control in it.
Yeah, the Holy Spirit's a gentleman, and he doesn't force you to do anything.
No.
He doesn't force you to speak in tongues. He doesn't force you to lay your hands on the sick to heal them.
Mm.
So he works with us. Mm. We come into a partnership with the Holy Spirit, and then we go and we work together. But there's never him forcing. The devil compels you to do things. He forces you to do things.
Mm.
Oftentimes people will come to us and say, like, how do I know I have a demon? And my first question is, what sin do you struggle with?
Mm.
What are you bound to?
Mm.
What are you a slave to? If you are a slave and you have no control, then it's demonic.
Something's compelling you to
Then something's wrong. Mm. But the Holy Spirit, he's a gentleman.
Mm.
We work with him.
Mm.
He doesn't compel me.
Force
he doesn't possess me.
Mm.
We work together.
Yeah. So this was a little about holy laughter and drunken spirit. Then there's the whole gold dust things.
Feathers.
The thing is that we believe the Holy Spirit can do things, but I don't see in the Bible that those special manifestation is following certain ministries and certain people. But there's people who are professional now in gold, dust, and diamonds. Come on, I have been at meetings when I was new in the faith where they run around and light in the mouth and a woman, hey, I got a gold teeth, and everybody was clapping, and I was thinking, whoa, she got a gold teeth. Mm. Next week she remembered how when she got that fixed by the dentist. Mm. But in that moment she forgot it. Mm. Of course, maybe there's people, but I'm like, I believe God starts with the manifestation we see in the Bible. He will set people free from their sickness. Mm. He will set people free from their sins. Mm. And if God wants to do something, of course, I believe there is an openness. But as soon as people start to seek the manifestation, yeah, they stop preaching the gospel.
Yes.
They stop making disciples. They stop doing what we are called to do. And I've seen that. I've seen people start with a good focus of discipleship and end up with manifestation.
They get distracted by the manifestation.
Yeah. And I think often some of the things we see that go together with the whole teaching about impartation. Mm. Can I say something about impartation?
Yeah, I think this is something we see often now, and we see it a lot with people coming to the Kickstarts, and that they want an impartation, they want a fresh anointing, they want a special anointing. They'll come and rub up on Torben or want to touch us, and like, I want your anointing, I want an impartation from you. And it's because people, I think they still have an Old Testament mindset where the Holy Spirit would come, let's take Elijah or whatever, the Holy Spirit would come, he would perform his task, the Holy Spirit would go. So you're anointed for a task. Mm. But what we don't understand is in the New Testament, the Holy Spirit, when he comes and he stays.
Yes.
He says that he will never leave us nor forsake us. Mm. So, and he doesn't go stale. If you want the Holy Spirit to continue to flow through you, you have to continue to obey Jesus.
And obedience, yeah.
You have to walk out. If you give, he will keep coming. Mm. But if you stop, you can quench the work of the Holy Spirit. But that's through disobedience.
But you don't need a new impartation.
You don't need, the Holy Spirit doesn't go away. He's not going to, he says he will never leave you nor forsake you.
And the reason we do a video like this is because it's really, it is concerning us that we travel all over the world now and we meet people. And it's not an Old Testament mind. It's a wrong teaching that is in churches today, where there's a wrong focus on the whole thing of impartation. Yeah. And I see that every time I do a kickstart, every time people come to me, oh, Tom, can you pray for me? And I say, yes, are you sick? Do you need healing? No. But I really want what you have. Do you have the Holy Spirit? Mm. Yeah. Okay, you have it. Bye-bye. Mm. But where people are like, no, I want the anointing. What anointing? Mm. Well, I had the Spirit of Christ, the same Spirit you have that raised Jesus from the dead. Amen. The Spirit of Christ, we have him. Yes. And there's not a special anointing, a special gifting. And it really concerns me that also there's so many weird videos on YouTube and people are doing weird things. Sorry to say it, but there's something like grave stalking, where people think that they can go to grave of dead saints. Mm. I saw a video with Smith Wittenworth, a guy in England, who had a strong character. I don't know so much about, but strong faith, but also strong character, did not go wrong. Yeah. And then people went there to his grave to put hands on it, like, oh, I want this special knowledge because Smith Wittenworth did not go wrong in his end time and he lived a holy life and we want the same thing.
I want that anointing from
But him. Character, you don't get his character by a transferring of something.
Touching his
grave. I sometimes have people come to me, Tom, I want to walk in the same you have. Okay, you have the same Holy Spirit. If you want to walk in the same
Just
Spirit, the same, then walk the same walk.
Just do it. Yeah.
You have to go through the same hard thing of character. Yes. You had to die. You had to go through a desert. You had to build up discipline. You had to have a life with God. You had to pray.
Yes.
But people don't want to pray. People don't want to live a holy life. People don't want to take the cross up daily and follow him and be faithful in the small thing. They want somebody who will have it.
And they want it now.
And lay hands on them.
Yes.
And I think there is something really unhealthy in the whole impartation teaching. I don't see biblical.
No.
I see biblical laying hands on people to receive the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
But not like now I walked with God 15 years, I have built up something, But if I lay hands on you as a new believer, you don't need to walk the same walk. You can just start there. Yeah. God will never do like that.
I'm thinking about Ephesians 1:3. It talks about you've been blessed now with all the spiritual gifts in the heavenly places. I think something like that. So if you have the Holy Spirit, you have the fullness of the Holy Spirit.
And also, I was in London. There was people come to me that last keys on top, and please come with the Holy Spirit. I want to be baptized with the Holy Spirit. No, with fire. And it's like, oh, fire thing. Okay, what, can you read the scripture?
Yeah, we've got scripture here in Matthew.
And there's people think but there's an extra anointing. We need the Holy Spirit anointing, but we also need the fire anointing.
Yeah, it says here, it's like, John the Baptist is speaking, and he says, I baptize with water those who repent of their sins and turn to God. But someone is coming soon who is greater than I am, so much greater that I am not worthy even to be his slave and carry his sandals. He will baptize you with Holy Spirit and with fire.
And people stop there.
Yeah. So people stop here. So we say Jesus come, and John the Baptist is saying that he's baptizing
with water.
With water, but him who come after him, Jesus, will baptize with Holy Spirit.
And fire.
Yeah. But what is the fire baptism? And then we often say, but Book of Acts, there's tongues as fire. Yeah. That was the Holy Spirit baptism. That was not a fire baptism. That was the Holy Spirit baptized. But a tongue, if you go to James, a tongue is like a fire that can put the biggest wood on fire because there's power in the tongue. And we need to learn to control the tongue. Yeah. Fire in this context is talking about judgment. Yeah. First time Jesus came to baptize with Holy Spirit. Yeah. Next time he come to baptize judge. With fire. First time he come as a savior. Yes. Next time he come as a judge. Read the next verse.
So what clear. Is that
saying? Next verse, he is ready to separate the chaff from the wheat with his winnowing fork. Then he will clean up the threshing area, gathering the wheat into his barn, but burning the chaff with never-ending fire.
That's so clear, isn't it?
So he's so if people come say, oh, I want to be baptized with the holy fire. Do you want to be judged? Do you want Jesus to take you and throw you and burn you in everlasting fire? And I think we need to understand, we have everything in Christ, the Holy Spirit in us, but it's about holiness, it's about discipleship, it's about being faithful in the small things, taking your cross up, and all of that. So that we need to do this video because we do meetings, Kickstart, and more people come from different areas where they have got this wrong understanding, and they come to us all the time. And I have just, every time people come to me and say, hey Tom, can you pray for me? I really want your anointing. I know one thing. I know they're not seeing the Pioneer School.
Yes.
I'm like, okay, go and see the Pioneer School. I have seen it. No, you haven't. Because otherwise, you will not ask me for a special anointing. Because I can see you, we can pray for you for healing. We can cast out the demons. Mm-hmm. And you can receive the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This is what we can do. But But that is some of it. Ticks.
Yeah, this is something we see as well, this New Age thing coming in where people start to have strange manifestations. If you look at Eastern mysticism or the Eastern religions, and this is where we get into the Kundalini thing, you see the ticks and the creers. Mm. So you have people come and they think the Holy Spirit comes over them, but they have these really strange...
It's people who like...
They jerk.
Yeah, they're standing and tricking and...
Or shout stuff, words, like a sheep.
So we see them at meetings where people come and then, okay, let's pray for you. And they're standing and like, stop it, come on, I want to pray for you. So when you say Kundalini...
So it's a snake. It's basically some people
Hinduism.
And Hinduism, they have the Kundalini rising for you to open up to the spirit or to get the spirit to rise different ways. Yoga is one way, and we see that coming into the churches a lot now as well.
They just yoga, call it a Christian name,
or even through impartation. So the laying on of hands through a yogi to open up your
third eye
to get the spirit, the serpent spirit, to rise up your spine and give you a Kundalini awakening. Mm. And this actually gives you different things. So either you will be thrashing around on the floor and people think it's the Holy Spirit, unfortunately.
But that is not fleshly. We actually see this as real demonic.
This is demonic. Yes. Yeah. Or they have extreme feelings of euphoria, of love, of joy. They laugh. They do tick.
Mm.
we also see the other side of the spirit. When people, when you already know what you're looking for, we've had a few students come into some of our schools. They walk in, the spirit starts manifesting, but then they start cursing and blaspheming. Yeah. Because now he's not trying to pretend to be the Holy Spirit anymore. Mm. Now he is revealed.
Because he's been revealed, yeah.
But these people actually got this in churches. Mm. They did not do yoga, but they did get it through impartation with laying on of hands. Mm. And it's
quite messy. So we are actually saying, are we saying that a wrong demonic spirit, they call it Kundalini spirit, but I believe there is... I don't believe there is a Kundalini spirit, there is unclean spirit, but you see it like the Kundalini spirit in other religions. But an unclean demonic spirit has crept into the church.
Yes.
This is what we believe, and this is what we are saying, and we see it. And it's so sad to see it, because when we've been starting to travel a lot, I recognize it. And sometimes I'm like, oh no. When I have those meetings, kickstart, and I can see, okay, there is a group of people who's coming with this. And I can often see where they come from.
Yes.
Okay, they have been on this Bible school, or they have been part of this ministry. And I've said to somebody, hey, don't it worry you that I can actually see where you are from because of your manifestation.
Yes.
If this was the Holy Spirit, why can you always see it come from there or from there or from there?
Why is it limited to only one area?
Because it was where the wrong spirit came in, and it had been spreading from there, and you can recognize it. And we have dealt with many people on our pioneer training school who came with that.
Yes.
We have set people free from them. Sometimes it was a deliverance that needs to take place. We have also seen people really just have to take self-control and renew their mind and say, okay, this is not like that, and this is good.
Yeah.
And then they experience freedom in it.
Yeah.
But it is a big frustration to pray for people, because that thing is the Holy Spirit. And if that thing is the Holy Spirit, it's not easy to they don't want to set free from the Holy Spirit.
But the beautiful thing though is when they do get set free, they experience a true freedom. They really confess that, and it's beautiful to see how people really get set free.
For my own sake, people have also said to us that, hey, we are using the Kundalini spirit because they see videos where people are falling down and shaking. And yes, we have those manifestations on our videos.
Mm.
But you have to see, every time we see this manifestation, we often show it, sometimes we don't film it, but what is happening is when we see those manifestations and people fall down and shake, we don't stand and say, hallelujah, more Lord, more Lord. Because this is not the work of the Holy Spirit, that is demonic.
Yeah.
So we sit down and say, come out, demon, come out, demon.
Yeah.
And that demon is going.
Yes.
And that is what I would say, that it concerns me that there is ministries out there who have a lot of manifestation, but I've never seen them cast out demons.
Yes.
If there is manifestations, you know for sure that many of those manifestations are demonic.
Mm.
Demonic manifestation, we cast out.
Yes.
When the Holy Spirit is working, we let the Holy Spirit work.
Mm.
But there is people today, because they have never discerned what spirit, and they have crept in that New Age spirit, they mix it all together.
Mm. Yeah.
So they're like, oh, hallelujah, look there, and we have meetings today with a lot of demonic manifestations, and people don't cast out those demons. They worship it like it is the Holy Spirit. And that is why we need to do this video. We need to test the spirit by the fruit, by the word of God, and when I say fruit of the spirit, self-control and other things.
Fruit it produces in that person's life. Are they living a holy life, coming closer to God or not?
Yeah. And this is what I sometimes see that people who really come from areas where there's a lot of focus of manifestations, is more difficult to disciple them. Because they have an over-focus on feeling and emotion.
Yes.
And, oh, the Holy Spirit is saying, okay, let's do this. No, the Holy Spirit, don't speak to me like that. Hey, let's go. No, the Holy Spirit. And it becomes weird.
Mm.
We believe in being led by the Holy Spirit, but the Holy Spirit don't speak against each other, against itself. The Holy Spirit said, you are part of this, you now work with that. And we said, okay, let's go this way. Mm-hmm. The Holy Spirit do not say it's more, no, you go this way, you go this way.
Exactly.
Or changes his mind. Yeah. Today he tells you, you have to be here.
And tomorrow
he changed his mind. No, sorry, I made a mistake. You're not supposed to be there.
Yeah. So can you come with more... let's use some examples. Come with some examples how we meet the New Age Spirit in church and manifestations.
I think it was interesting. We had once casted out a demon out of a woman that was involved in New Age. So she came to Christ from New Age. She did yoga, transcendental meditation, full on New Age person. She heard the gospel, she came to faith, she was full of the Holy Spirit, baptized, and then she was being delivered. And it was a certain manifestation. We saw the ticks, we saw the creers, we saw this demon manifest, and we cast it out. Then we had another person that was a born-again believer, and I do this because they might have been, they might not, but they had the same manifestation as this New Age person, yet they were claiming it's the Holy Spirit. And then they had other sin in their life that they wanted freedom from. We asked them to renounce this manifestation as well. We prayed for them. Same manifestation as the New Age person. Mm. This time it was their Holy Spirit we cast out, which was not the
church.
Holy Spirit.
They received it in the church.
But they did receive this in the church.
So what we were saying is there was New Age person who in New Age had received a spirit, had experienced manifestation.
Yes.
She gets delivered. She comes in the church. Yes. She experienced the same manifestation.
This is another person okay. that has received that manifestation, that spirit, but in a church.
Yeah.
But so
it's
two
same.
Separate
so it's the same
people.
Spirit who was outside church, knew it, and who was inside church.
Exactly.
But it was actually easier to set the New Age woman free because she knew that it was a wrong spirit where the Christian thought it was the Holy Spirit.
Exactly. But then we've also had an example, do you remember in England, when we had a guy come to our kickstart. And he was also a New Ager. Completely, he was opening up chakras and who knows what else he was up to.
He was quite high in the New
Age. He was very high up in the New Age. And then he realized there must be more. So he started searching out Jesus. He actually decided to give his life to Jesus. He started reading the Bible, got excited. What do? I'm a believer now. I'm going to go to church. So he goes to one of these really big churches in London where you see a lot of these manifestations. He walks into the church. People are rolling around, carrying on, and he goes, oh, I know this. Mm. This is where I come from.
Mm. This is the same spirit.
This is the same spirit. So immediately this New Age man recognized the spirit as well. And
the first thing that happened with him, he questioned it. But as soon as he questioned it, as he said, this is the same New Age spirit.
Fear gripped him,
condemnation, you've blasphemed the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
And immediately he said to himself, I promise I will never speak against this again. Holy Spirit, please come back. I will never speak. And he just went along with it. But he was so bound by wrong spirits. So when he came to one of our kickstarts, he just wanted to receive the gift of speaking in tongues. So we prayed for him, but he's... strong manifestations. He didn't have any control, really, really strong manifestations. And we're like, what is going on here, Lord? At one stage, we got him to renounce all these things and we baptized him. And this guy, a Russian guy, barely speaking English, started mocking me, the spirit mocking me in my native language, Afrikaans. And this is the things that we come across. These spirits, it's not just a fleshy manifestation. Mm. These are real demonic manifestations.
But he was set free.
But he was set free from that, and that's the important thing.
He realized that that was not the Holy Spirit he encountered.
And how do freedom come? Freedom come by realizing, come by repentance. You cannot repent something you love.
Yes.
You have to hate it. You have to change your mind. And then it's power in the gospel, repentance, baptism, and so on. You also saw like people start with New Age. We do the kickstarts. And people sometimes come in and we have seen people try to do, what was that?
Yeah, so it's a weird thing. We were in America recently and as we came outside, there was a person that's actually busy doing muscle testing, they call this, which is actually a very New Age thing as well. And what they do is they ask the person to stick out the hand and then they try to see the force of the muscle. So they will speak to the muscle and say, to the body and say, I'm going to ask you some questions. If it's a yes answer, you will have strength to resist me. If it's a no answer, you don't have power. And then what the person that they pray for actually experience, they cannot resist. Mm. So something is blocking, or you cannot open the hand, for example. Yeah. So something is actually blocking this person from opening his hand.
And he was a Christian.
A Christian.
Yeah. Well, they claim
to be a Christian. But this is New Age thing. This is what you see out in the world.
Yeah. Exactly.
Also, the whole visualization. We see that a lot where people visualize, like, now we go in and imagine, and that is, can you say something about that?
Yes. Yeah, this is also another thing we see often coming into our schools now, where people, they go for counseling sessions, and they go for what they call inner healing or theophostics, and now also they're starting to do this in Sozo, where it's also called regressive therapy. So people, if they've had a big trauma or a big hurt, they have to visualize, they have to go back to this trauma and they have to visualize the situation. And then they have to visualize Jesus in the situation. Jesus, where were you in this? So they see it. They actually do see this Jesus come in and speak and different things. And a lot of people actually claim to get a lot of healing. Mm. But what they don't realize is they're actually opening themselves up for a familiar spirit. Because visualization is, it's not a vision from God. Mm. A vision from God, we know you're sitting there next moment, God gives you a vision. You did not conjure it up. You did not seek it. He gave it to you. But this is, you are conjuring. You are going in your mind and you are creating the picture or going back to the memory. Mm. And now they open themselves up for a familiar spirit, which they think is Jesus. Mm. And we've actually had a very strong testimony very recently
in Canada,
in one of the schools. We had a young woman. Clearly something was very wrong over there. Her eyes kept on going up in her head and white. Every time we pray. Like, what is going on here? So we prayed for God to give us an opportunity to be able to pray for her. Started praying. Next moment, she's on the floor, slithering around like a snake.
Blowing eyes, her faces.
Yeah, eyes completely open, but white. Mm. White, white, white. And she can't get them back. So we pray. Things leave, but this one thing won't go. And it's like, what is this thing holding on? And she sits up and she just goes, Jesus.
With white eyes. Jesus.
White eyes. And I'm like, ah. Oh. You've learned to visualize.
We asked, did you visualize?
She says, it's like, I can't see him. Mm. It's like, you are visualizing. You normally see Jesus, don't you? Yes, and I can't see him. It's like, this is not the Jesus of the Bible. Mm. So she was taught. She was taught in church how to see, how to look up, how to visualize Jesus. And it was a familiar spirit that
came in. This was so strong. As soon as we identified this and we said, this is not the Jesus from the Bible, she went, pah! Mm. And suddenly the revelation came to her and she repented from that, and that thing just left straight away.
Just left.
And she was so angry. She said, I'm so upset. I'm so angry. I was deceived. He said, you just did not know. You just didn't know.
I would say, well, if we look at manifestations like that, these signs follow those who believe. We are not following the signs. They follow us. We don't promote them. And I've seen people like here, I've heard people say, hey, I saw three men came to me. And I'm like, I don't have a problem if people realize seeing angels. Angels are real.
Yes.
But what went before that? She read a book about it, and she every morning like, holy, I want to see angels. And she was seeking, and she was trying to create it. She was seeking that manifestation. Yeah. And in all of that, she actually opened up for wrong spirit. But I have had experience where it was like out of body. I've experienced hell and heaven. One time hell, one time heaven. It was a real experience for me. It was some of the strongest experience I had in my life. Especially with hell, I don't know if it was real or not real when I was there. It was real to me. Mm. I did not seek it. It came. Mm. And even when it was real to me, you don't hear me talk a lot about it, because if I talk a lot about it, people will build doctrines on it, and I will not build doctrines on it. Mm-hmm. Because even so it was real to me, I know I can be deceived. Mm. It changed me, it did something in me. It made me more serious when it comes to heaven and hell and why I'm here and what is happening afterwards. Mm. But I will never be able to have a meeting and give my experience to other people by saying something they need to do to experience the same. Because there's nothing they should do to experience the same, because we are not seeking it. No. Seek God, seek Jesus, make disciples, and if God give it to you, be happy for it. If not, be thankful for that.
Yes.
So I would say that we are not, again, understand, don't be against manifestation. Don't seek manifestation. Seek God, seek the work, make disciples. And I think if we have a true understanding on the word, sign will follow and the Holy Spirit will be part of our life. I encourage you to see the Pioneer School. The Pioneer School, we talk about discipleship, we talk about the gospel, we talk about many things. And the Pioneer School and the Kickstarts have been the starting for many people to come into a supernatural life with God, where the Holy Spirit is falling and so on. But it came because we were making disciples, not because we were seeking manifestations. So try things, hold on to what is good. You can see on video, on YouTube, see some of those videos. If you see Drunk in Spirit, Gold or so, there's the thing you can see, but don't spend all your time there. Also because we still have to have a little skeptic, because I believe there's maybe people out there who did this years ago, but they don't do it today because they have been matured and they have grown up. Because I also did things 20 years ago as a new believer I don't do today, but I'm happy that there was no YouTube at that time. So don't judge people out of old video that's 20, 30 years ago that say, hey, they are part of the Drunken Spirit. We don't know where they are today. But we need to still test things. We need to discern and look at the fruit and what is the Bible saying about. Do you want to say something in the end?
I think just very shortly, we see two types of people. One type of a person will seek what the Holy Spirit can do for them. They chase the manifestations, all these things. The other person wants to know the Holy Spirit for who he is as a person. We need to seek God for relationship. And I just want to encourage everybody out there, seek God for the relationship. I was there, I was deceived, and God has really set me free. And I want to encourage you out there as well. Don't be afraid now. God, we want to be you to be free in this area, but God wants you to be free even more than what we want you to be free. So if you call out to God, he will show you.
Yeah. So we're saying, so don't seek the manifestation, seek the truth. If you are part of this manifestation and this video have shocked you, like how can you, the last Reformation who believe in deliverance and heal the sick and cast out demons, doing all of this, how can you warn against this? Because we see it's unbiblical, all of those things. Therefore, we warn against it. But if that had shocked you, then ask God. Say, God, I don't want to be deceived. I want to know what is the truth. Yes. And then don't seek the manifestation. Seek the truth. And then we believe that the Holy Spirit will lead you out of it. Yes. Show you the truth the same way he has shown us the truth. So we have nothing to do with those weird things anymore. And I think that is the thing. But if you hold on to the manifestation, like, no, but I want a manifestation. Be careful, please. Don't go there. And I would say also for the last Reformation, this is not what we believe in. And I need to say it so clear, and this is not what we want. This is not part of us. And we are not part of those movements who are doing those things because we believe it's demonic. Yes. We believe there's so many demonic things. And we need to be more aware of it. And that's why we have done this video.
Yeah. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and then these things will follow.
Amen.
So your eyes on Jesus and just making disciples, obeying him, living a holy life, a righteous life. Read the book of Acts. Does your life look like that? You're on the right path.
Yeah. So see the Pioneer School, see the movie, 7 Days Adventure with God, see the movie, The Last Reformation. The next movie, The Last Reformation, The Life will come out very, very soon. It's going to be a beautiful video where you're going to see the work of the Holy Spirit. You're going to see deliverance, healing, how people are filled with the Spirit, how life is changed, how people are living a holy life as a disciple of Christ. You're going to see the gospel through the whole movie. We're talking about the cross. We're talking about Jesus. Through the whole movie, persecution, we're talking about it all. So God bless you out there. See the videos and have a good day. Bye-bye.
Be blessed.